judges of the Superior Court of the State of Connecticut. I'm Judge Pat Carroll, and I serve as Chief Court Administrator. Due to the challenges presented by the COVID-19 crisis, we are conducting the judges' annual meeting via Microsoft Teams this year. And because of that, I have a couple of housekeeping matters we must first take care of. First, Judge Elgo, you have to turn off your camera. We are asking everybody to turn off their cameras so that, and there we go. Thank you, Judge Elgo. All right, you should also know that the moderator has put this call, everyone on this call, on mute at this point. And at the appropriate time, I will let you know when you should unmute yourself so you may vote. Please note that it may take a few seconds for you to be unmuted. I would also ask again, if you are not presenting during the meeting, that you turn your video off. Please be aware that this meeting is being live streamed on the Judicial Branch's YouTube channel, so members of the public may observe our proceedings. Our judge trial referees are also accessing the meeting by way of YouTube. So I ask you all for your patience and forbearance in the event that we encounter any technical difficulties during this meeting. Judge Bizzuto and I are participating in the meeting here in the attorney conference room at the Connecticut Supreme Court. Chief Justice Robinson and Justice McDonald are participating from their chambers here at the Supreme Court, and others are participating from their respective offices or at other locations. I remind you again that several votes of the judges will be taken during this meeting. The votes will be taken by voice vote. Again, before any such vote is taken, I will remind you to unmute yourself. If there are any no votes or abstentions, any judge who casts such a no vote or an abstention will be asked to identify him or herself for the record in order to allow the minutes of this meeting to accurately reflect all of the votes taken. Hopefully, though, all votes today will be unanimous, thereby eliminating the need to identify no votes or abstentions on the record. Before we get to the business of the meeting, I want to extend my gratitude to all of the judges and judicial branch staff who have worked so hard since the COVID-19 crisis commenced in early March to assure that we could meet our constitutional obligations to get arraignments, domestic violence matters, habeas corpus proceedings, and other important matters handled in a timely fashion. Very early on in this crisis, we shrunk our operations to only 6 courthouses statewide. Today, we have some 53 of 72 judicial branch offices and courthouses open and safely conducting business. We have secured and provide personal protection equipment to all of our staff and judges working in these facilities. We've installed plexiglass protective barriers, enhanced our cleaning and sanitization protocols, and deployed hand sanitization stations throughout our workplaces to assure the highest degree of health and safety to our employees and judges. We have created and deployed a daily self-screening tool for judges and employees, reminding them not to come to work if they are experiencing any COVID-like symptoms. We have worked closely with public health officials to assure that we are doing all we can do to protect our workforce and the public and to mitigate risk of the virus in all of our open facilities. Significantly, we have also deployed a vast array of new virtual processes that allow us to conduct a wide range of civil, family, criminal, and juvenile proceedings remotely. The newest of these processes includes a tool which represents a collaboration between Microsoft Teams and our digital audio recording platform, FTR, and allows virtual remote proceedings to seamlessly integrate with our FTR system, thereby enabling remote proceedings to be conducted on the record. This opens up possibilities to conduct court business remotely, regardless of the public health challenges posed by the current COVID-19 conditions, or the conditions we may confront with the possibility of a second surge of the virus in the coming months. As you know, Supreme and appellate court arguments are also being conducted remotely, and that too has been a very successful deployment of our virtual technology. Our IT team warrants special recognition for the remarkable job they have done in getting these processes up and running in a relatively short period of time. I also want to thank our chief administrative judges, Judge Abrams, Judge Alexander, Judge Aldis, and Judge Conway, and all of our administrative judges for their creativity and collaboration as we develop new methods to meet the challenge of the COVID-19 pandemic. And to all of our judges and JTRs, thank you for your cooperation and your patience as we navigated through these unprecedented waters together. Thanks as well to the executive directors of our Court Operations Division, our Court Support Services Division, Administrative Services Division, Judicial Information Systems Division, and External Affairs Division, with whom I have met every single morning since early March to plan, strategize, and implement procedures to get our work done and to keep our facilities safe and healthy. Most importantly, though, to our dedicated judicial branch employees, thank you for your commitment to the important work we do. Thank you for your concern for each other. No matter how great the challenges have been, our employees have stepped up to the plate to find a way to get our work done. Though the challenges ahead will be great, I have no doubt with this team in place, we will be able to meet and overcome those challenges. Finally, I must acknowledge the tireless work of Judge Bizzuto. She's assumed the lion's share of managing our operational response to the COVID-19 crisis, and she's been a remarkable and reliable partner through it all. So thank you, Judge Bizzuto. Now, before I have the honor of introducing our Chief Justice, let me not forget to ask you that you unmute so we may deal with the minutes from last year's meeting. Before we vote on those minutes, I would like to make one correction on page 2 of the minutes. In the third paragraph, the word elected should be inserted before the words constitutional officers. At this time, I'd ask for a motion from the floor to approve the minutes of the meeting of June 13, 2019 as corrected, which were posted on the Connecticut Judicial Branch's website. May I have such motion, please?
Judge Gotti, the acceptance of the minutes as amended this morning from the meeting of June 13, 2019.
I believe I heard Judge Falagatti made the motion. May I have the second?
Second.
And I believe Judge Anna Facito seconded the motion. So the motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please signify by saying aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
Thank you. I will again ask that everyone please turn off the video on your computers. We have several judges who are appearing on screen when they should not be. Now it is my great honor to introduce Connecticut's Chief Justice Richard A. Robinson. Good morning, Chief Justice.
Good morning, Pat. Good morning, everyone. I want to ask you if you're okay, because I know that we all are having difficulties during these extraordinary times. So welcome to the judges meeting of 2020. This is the first time the annual meeting has been conducted remotely, and I'm very pleased that all of you have been able to join and participate. I also think it would be an understatement to suggest that 2020 has been like no other year any of us have ever experienced. To think of where we are at the beginning of March as opposed to where we are today is really pretty mind-boggling. There's an old African proverb that says, smooth waters do not make great sailors. Yeah. The waters have been rough, but you have proven to be great sailors. We are going to come out ahead on this as a stronger, more efficient, more nimble judicial branch. And there are many people to thank for getting us here and continuing to push forward. First, I want to thank each and every one of you, the judges, for your commitment to resolving the matters brought before you, regardless of whatever obstacles may pop up. Your professionalism and your desire to assist in adapting to this new world is truly a model of excellence. I also want to thank our four chief administrative judges, Jim Abrams, Mike Albus, Joan Alexander, and Bernadette Conway, for their creativity, passion, and energy, their ability to transform their intimate knowledge of their respective disciplines into concrete, measurable actions. To the four of you, we are all deeply in your debt. Also at the top of my thank you list are our valued employees. When you think about it, none of this would have been possible without them and their willingness to serve so selflessly during a tumultuous time. To each of them, and particularly those on the front lines at the beginning of this pandemic, please accept our gratitude for all that you have done. While I'm on the subject of our employees, I need to give a special nod to our IT staff. I know that we have pushed them far beyond their limits. Unfortunately, it was something that we absolutely needed to do in order to perform our most basic functions. The people of the state of Connecticut were counting on us, and we in turn were counting on them. They rose to the challenge, and we are grateful for their commitment and their sacrifice. Normally, at this point, I would try to thank Judge Carroll and Judge Bizzuto, but throughout all the various crises, including but not limited to our constant skirmishes with ICE over arresting people on court property, our never-ending budget battles, our seemingly eternal struggle to get fair compensation for the judges and excluded employees, and to get us through this COVID-19 crisis, our dilapidated and deteriorated physical infrastructure and tech infrastructure, and a call to action to resolve racial injustice in our country's law enforcement and judicial systems. They have been on the front line since day one, and every time that I've said to them, I want to thank you for all that you do, they responded to me, Rick, that's not necessary. This is what we do. So I won't say thank you to them, but I will say thank you. I will say your great works and your good counsel has always been and always will be greatly appreciated. The branch could have not gotten where it is if you had not been where you were. I wish I could tell all of you that the worst is behind us. But to quote Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., we have some difficult days ahead. The challenges that we are facing as a judiciary, as a state, and as a nation are unprecedented. But I know that we can and that we will get through this together. Some of you may be asking yourselves, why am I so confident in that outcome? The answer is simple. Every day I get to work with some of the most incredible people on this planet. And if anyone is up to the task, it's you. Although we are social distancing, I've never felt closer to you in my entire life. Thank you for this opportunity to address you today. I would now like to turn the meeting back over to Judge Carroll.
Thank you, Justice Robinson, for those kind remarks. At this point, I also have the high honor of introducing Associate Justice Andrew McDonald, Chair of the Rules Committee, who will present the next two agenda items, first being the review of the rules changes recommended by the Rules Committee, for which he will seek your approval. Second being the consideration of the emergency rules adopted by the Rules Committee in light of the public health and civil preparedness emergencies declared by Governor Lamont. Justice McDonald.
Thank you, Judge Carroll. Let me first start by thanking our incredible legal staff for the Rules Committee, who have also stepped up under extraordinary circumstances this year to assist the committee, and in particular, Joe Del Campo, Shanna O'Donnell, and Lori Petrozelli, who have worked tirelessly on our behalf and therefore on behalf of all judges. I'd also like to thank the members of the Rules Committee for their hard work under very trying circumstances, including emergency meetings on short notice this year. Those judges are Judge Avery Whetstone, Judge Alexander, Judge Bellis, Judge Cobb, Judge Cradle, Judge Heller, Judge Stevens, and Judge Truglia. And it is only because of the significant amount of work that they have put in that I have to share with you a rather extended report, and I ask your forbearance. Practice Book Section 1-9B provides the Rules Committee of the Superior Court with emergency powers to adopt on an interim basis any new rules and to amend or suspend in whole or in part on an interim basis any existing rules concerning practice and procedure in the Superior Court in the event that the governor declares a public health or civil preparedness emergency, both of which he declared on March 10th. Pursuant to Section 1-9B, a meeting of the Rules Committee was held on March 24th, 2020, and a second meeting was held on May 11th, 2020. At those meetings, the Rules Committee adopted, on an interim basis, a new rule and amended or suspended various existing rules concerning practice and procedure in the Superior Court that the committee deemed it necessary in light of the circumstances of the declared emergency. Those rules and a memorandum from me were forwarded to you on June 22nd for use at this meeting. Pursuant to Section 1-9B of the Practice Book, the adoption of the new rule and the amendment or suspension of existing rules shall remain in effect for the duration of the declared emergency or until such time, as soon as practicable, as a meeting of the Superior Court judges can be convened to consider a vote on the changes. With four exceptions, it is recommended that those changes remain in effect as adopted by the Rules Committee for the duration of the declared emergency. The first exception is as regards the suspension of Section 2-27A concerning minimum continuing legal education, also known as MCLE. The Commission on MCLE has requested that application of the MCLE requirements be suspended for calendar year 2020, and that any MCLE credits earned by attorneys in 2020 be allowed to be carried over completely to 2021, even if the amount exceeds the two-hour cap provided for in the rule. The second exception to allowing the rules amended under Section 1-9B to remain in effect for the duration of the emergency is the amendment to the legal intern rules in Sections 3-14 through 3-21 of the Practice Book to expand those rules to certified law school graduates. It is recommended that the expansion of those rules be effective from May 11th, 2020, the date the Rules Committee amended those rules and made the changes effective, until no later than November 15th, 2021. The final two exceptions concern the suspension of Section 23-68, which allows the use of interactive audio-visual devices in civil and family matters, and the suspension of Section 44-10A, which allows the use of such devices in certain specified criminal matters. It is recommended that those rules be modified to clarify that nothing in those rules shall be construed to preclude the judicial branch at the discretion of the Chief Court Administrator from handling any matter remotely. It is intended that any such remote proceedings before being implemented will be scrutinized under all applicable law to determine that such handling is appropriate. Now, when it's time to vote on these motions, please make sure that you cast your votes in accordance with the rules that Judge Carroll noted. That is to say, unmute your microphone and press the microphone button, which you will see on the toolbar. And remember, there is no need to vote in the affirmative. We have everybody registered, and we have a full attendance list of all judges who are attending. So only those votes that are in the negative or are not voting should be noted for the record. And if you do so, please state your name so that the minutes can properly reflect your negative vote or non-participation. Therefore, I move the adoption by unanimous consent of the amendments to Practice Book Section 2-27A as requested by the Commission on Minimum Continuing Legal Education. Is there a second?
Second.
I believe it was seconded by Judge Gotti and Judge Pacito. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all negative votes, please say no. All not voting, please indicate. Hearing none, that passes unanimously. Second, I move the adoption by unanimous consent of the expansion of the legal intern rules, section 3-14 through 3-21 of the Practice Book, to certified law school graduates as requested by the Connecticut Bar Examining Committee. Is there a second?
Second.
It was seconded by Judge Pacito and Judge Agati. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all negative votes, please indicate no now. Are there any abstentions? Hearing none, that passes unanimously. Third, I move adoption by unanimous consent of the amendments to Section 23-68 and Section 44-10A concerning the use of interactive audiovisual devices in civil, family, and criminal matters as explained earlier. Is there a second?
Second.
Been seconded by both Judges Agati and Facito. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all negative votes, please say no. All abstentions, please indicate so. Hearing none, that passes unanimously. I move the adoption by unanimous consent of the remaining changes adopted by the Rules Committee pursuant to Section 1-9B of the Practice Book as adopted, amended, or suspended by the Rules Committee. Is there a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded by Judge Gotti and Judge Facito. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all negative votes, please indicate no. All abstentions, please indicate that you're abstaining. That passes unanimously. This one's a long one. I further move by unanimous consent as regards the amendments of sections 2-27A that were just adopted. One, that the provisions of section 1-9B requiring publication of the revisions and that a public hearing be noticed and held prior to the adoption of revisions to the practice book be waived because those amendments should be adopted expeditiously. Two, that the amendments as adopted become effective on promulgation, including publication in the Connecticut Law Journal on an interim basis until a public hearing has been held on them and the judges have thereafter acted on such and they have become effective. And three, that the provisions of section 1-9A requiring that a rule not become effective less than 60 days after promulgation be waived because circumstances require that those amendments be adopted expeditiously. B, as regards the amendments of the legal intern rules that were just adopted, one, that the provision of section 1-9B requiring publication of the rules and that a public hearing be noticed and held prior to the adoption of the revisions to the practice book be waived because those amendments should be adopted expeditiously. Two, that the amendments become effective on May 11, 2020, the date adopted by the Rules Committee, on an interim basis until a public hearing has been held on them and the judges have thereafter acted on such, and that they become effective but until no later than November 15, 2021. And three, that the provisions of section 1-9 subsection A requiring that a rule not become effective less than 60 days after promulgation be waived because circumstances require that those amendments be adopted expeditiously. C, as regards the amendments of section 23-68 and section 44-10A that were just adopted, one, that the provisions of section 1-9 subsection B requiring publication of the revisions and that a public hearing be noticed and held prior to the adoption of the revisions to the practice book be waived because those amendments should be adopted expeditiously. Two, that the amendments as adopted become effective on promulgation, including publication in the Connecticut Law Journal on an interim basis until a public hearing has been held on them and the judges have thereafter acted on such and they have become effective. And three, that the provisions of section 1-9 subsection A requiring that a rule not become effective less than 60 days after promulgation be waived because circumstances require that those amendments be adopted expeditiously. D, as regards the remaining changes adopted by the Rules Committee that were just adopted, one, that the provision of section 1-9B requiring publication of the revisions and that a public hearing be noticed and held prior to the adoption of the revisions to the practice book be waived because those amendments should be adopted expeditiously. Two, that the changes become effective on March 24th, 2020, the date adopted by the Rules Committee on an interim basis until a public hearing has been held on that and the judges have thereafter acted on such and they have become effective but not until no later than the duration of the declared emergency. And three, that the provisions of section 1-9 subsection A requiring that a rule not become effective less than 60 days after promulgation be waived because circumstances require that those changes be adopted expeditiously. And finally, E, that the reporter of judicial decisions may make editorial changes to the amendments, including changes in the section numbers. Please don't ask me to repeat that. Is there a second?
Second.
Been seconded by Judge Agati and Judge Facito. Mm-hmm. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, any negative votes, please indicate no. Hearing no votes, are there any abstentions? Hearing none, that passes unanimously. I appreciate your participation and your tolerance of that very long report. I'll hand this back over to Judge Carroll.
Year after year, the chair of the Rules Committee has the most challenging role in the annual meeting. And this year, as you always do, Justice McDonald, you did a masterful job in assuring that our minutes would be accurate. We need to be precise, and you certainly were. I will also apologize to you. I gave Justice McDonald my assurance that I would explain the voting process and note that we were taking no votes only, and I neglected to do so. But you did a wonderful job explaining that, and that is the process we will utilize for the balance of the vote. So thank you again, Justice McDonald. At this point, we move to item 6 on the agenda, which is the election by the judges of 4 judges to be members of the Rules Committee of the Superior Court. At this point, I call on Judge Pavia to present the nominations for those 4 positions. Judge Pavia.
Good morning. On behalf of the nomination committee, and that committee includes Judges Frank Iannotti, Robert Nastri, and Charles Lee, I would like to make the following nomination. With regard to the Rules Committee, we would like to nominate Judge John Farley to replace the expiring term of Judge Barry Stevens. I would also like to renominate Judges Susan Cobb, Anthony Trulia, and Holly Avery Whetstone to continue another 1-year term in the positions that they currently hold on the Rules Committee. Is there any motion from the floor?
So moved.
So I'm not able to hear.
I believe Judge Pavia, you made the motion, I believe it was Judge Agati again who seconded the motion.
All right, thank you. All right,
so a motion has made and seconded. Is there any discussion? If not, following the procedure established by Justice McDonald on the roll, on the votes for the rules, I would now call for any no votes. Are there any no votes?
All right. Let me run down there.
Are there any abstentions? There being no votes nor any abstentions, that motion is unanimously adopted. Next, we move on to a motion for the election of a judges to be recommended to the governor for membership on the Judicial Review Council. Again, I will call on Judge Pavia to make that motion.
Thank you. This particular year, we have 1 expiring term. The nomination committee would like to nominate Judges Sal Agati and Dan Shaven for submission to the governor, one of whom shall be appointed by the governor for a 4-year term to replace the expiring term of Judge John Kavanewski as a regular member of the Judicial Review Council commencing December 1st, 2020. Are there
I'm sorry? All right, motion has been made by Judge Pavia. Is there a second?
Second.
That's Judge Facito. Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? If there is no discussion, I will again ask if there are any no votes. Are there any abstentions? There being no votes or abstentions recorded, the motion is unanimously adopted and approved. Thank you, Judge Pavia.
Thank you, Judge Carroll.
And I just noted that I made another error. I have to go back to Justice McDonald for 1 additional matter that needs to be taken up on the rules. So at this point, I'll call on Justice McDonald.
Thank you, Judge Carroll, and you're very kind. It was actually my error because we are doing not only the emergency rules, but the regular rules that we worked on before the civil preparedness emergency was declared, I neglected to do that part of the first half of the year's work. And it did allow me to get a sip of water. So I guess that was a good thing. So I will continue now with respect to the summary of the practice book revisions that were undertaken by the Rules Committee before the Civil Preparedness Emergency and Health Emergency. So the revisions of the practice book under consideration today and a memorandum, as I indicated, were forwarded previously to you. And these proposed revisions were the subject of a public hearing conducted by the Rules Committee on June 5th, 2020, and reflect comments received at that hearing and during the course of the meetings held by the Rules Committee. The proposals include the following: revisions to the Rules of Professional Conduct. There includes a revision to the commentary to Rule 7.1 regarding communications concerning a lawyer's services to clarify references to professional misconduct. There's also a revision to the commentary to Rule 7.3 regarding lawyer solicitation to clarify that live person-to-person solicitation of certain vulnerable individuals when a significant motivation is financial gain is inappropriate. Secondly, there are revisions to the general provisions of the Superior Court rules. The revisions to Section 1-10B and 1-11C, allowing media coverage of a homicide case involving sexual assault, provided that the victim's family has affirmatively consented, no family member has objected, and the family has been notified of such coverage. There are also revisions to Sections 2-3, 2-4, 2-4A, 2-5, 2-6, 2-8, 2-9, 2-10, 2-11, 2-11A, 2-13, 2-13A, 2-15A, and 2-18, changing language when referring to the Bar Examining Committee for consistency. Additionally, there is a revision to Section 2-4A regarding records of the Bar Examining Committee, clarifying who may access records that are not open to the public. A revision to Section 2-8 regarding qualifications for admission to the bar, removing references to two repealed sections of the practice book. There are also revisions to Section 2-8 and 2-13, clarifying that the Bar Examining Committee does not administer an examination in professional responsibility, but rather that each applicant for admission to the bar has either passed an examination in professional responsibility approved or required by the committee, or has completed a course in professional responsibility in accordance with the regulations of the committee. There's also a revision to Section 2-9 regarding certification of applicants recommended for admission to the bar, removing the requirement for the Bar Examining Committee to certify to the clerk of the Superior Court in New Haven all recommendations for admission and replacing the term disability with more neutral and inclusive language. There are also revisions to Section 2-11 and 2-11A regarding conditional admission to the bar and appeals of such conditions, allowing disclosure of certain information to disciplinary counsel or with consent of the applicant or attorney to any other agency or person. There's also a revision to Section 2-12 regarding county committees on the recommendations for admission to the bar to conform the rule to current practice. Additionally, there is a revision to Section 2-13 regarding qualifications and admission to the bar of attorneys from other jurisdictions, removing the requirement that an applicant for admission intends to practice law in Connecticut on a continuing basis and clarifying that affidavits submitted in support of such an application for admission must be submitted by the affiant, not the applicant. Additionally, there is a revision to Section 2-15A regarding authorized house counsel to clarify that authorized house counsel applications are accepted within 3 months before or 3 months after someone begins work in Connecticut. There's additionally a revision to Section 2-27A regarding minimum continuing legal education to clarify that credit for writing and publication of articles shall be based on the time required for both researching and drafting such articles. There are also revisions to Sections 2-29, 5-3, and 6-1 to conform the terminology for official court reporters and court recording monitors to the provisions of Public Act 19-64. There's also a revision to subsection B of section 3-8 concerning appearances for self-represented parties to address the Supreme Court's decision in In Re Taija HB and to correspond with the proposed revisions to the appellate rules, which will be before the appellate judges for adoption very soon. The revisions to section 3-8 specifies that limited appearances pursuant to section 79A-3C1 are permitted in juvenile cases. The revisions to the civil rules include a revision to section 16-12 regarding viewing by the jury of the place or thing involved in the case to conform the terminology for official court reporters and court recording monitors to the provisions of Public Act 19-64. It also includes revisions to sections 23-55 and 23-63 regarding hearings in fact finding and hearings in arbitration, respectively, substituting Connecticut Code of Evidence for Civil Rules of Evidence as the appropriate reference to evidentiary rules. The revisions to the juvenile rules include a revision to section 33A-1 regarding attaching a summary of the facts substantiating the allegations of a petition for neglect, uncared for, dependency, or termination of parental rights, inserting language into subsection B to make that subsection consistent with General Statute 46B-129A. There are also revisions to section 35A-21 concerning appeals in child protection matters to address the Supreme Court's decision in In Re Taija HB and to correspond with the proposed revisions to the appellate rules, which will, as I indicated, be before the appellate judges for adoption very soon. So those revisions would also allow for additional time for extensions of time to file an appeal and termination of parental rights cases and set forth the procedure if the reviewing attorney determines that there is merit to an appeal. The revisions to the criminal rules include revisions to sections 42-6, 43-10, and 43-24 to conform the terminology for official court reporters and court recording monitors to the provisions of Public Act 19-64. There are also revisions to section 44-27 and 44-30, substituting Connecticut Code of Evidence for Criminal Rules of Evidence as the appropriate reference to the evidentiary rules. As I indicated previously, we will be taking these as negative votes. And so I would first move the adoption of the amendments to the practice book, which were forwarded to you for use at this meeting. Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
It's been moved by, it's been seconded by Judge Agati and Judge Pasito. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, are there any negative votes? Hearing no negative votes, are there any abstentions? That passes unanimously. I therefore further move A, as regards the amendments of section 3-8 and 35A-21 that were just adopted to address the Supreme Court's decision in In Re Taija HB, one, that the provision of sections 1-9B requiring publication of the revisions and that a public hearing be noticed and held prior to the adoption of revisions to the practice book be waived because those amendments should be adopted expeditiously. And two, that the provisions as adopted become effective on promulgation, including publication in the Connecticut Law Journal on an interim basis until a public hearing has been held on them and the judges have thereafter acted on such and they have become effective. And three, that the provisions of section 1-9 subsection A requiring that a rule not become effective less than 60 days after promulgation be waived because circumstances require that those amendments be adopted expeditiously as well. And B, that the rest of the amendments to the practice book as just adopted become effective on January 1st, 2021. And C, that the reporter of judicial decisions may make editorial changes to the amendments, including changes in the section numbers. Is there a second?
Second.
Been seconded by Judge Pasito. Is there any discussion? Hearing no discussion, are there any negative votes? Hearing no negative votes, are there any abstentions? Hearing no abstentions, that passes unanimously, and I appreciate your patience. Thank you, and I'll turn it back to Judge Carroll.
Justice McDonald, thank you again for your care and precision in reporting those matters to the judges. At this point, I'll move on to item number 8 of the agenda. That is the approval of the report of the... Am I muted? No, I think I can be heard.
Okay. It was on my end. Thank you.
Okay. This, again, is with respect to the report of the Executive Committee. The Executive Committee, at its meeting on May 26, 2020, made recommendations to the full bench concerning annual appointments of certain judicial branch employees and individuals to serve on various panels and committees for the judicial branch. These recommendations, again, were approved by the Executive Committee at that meeting and were posted on the Connecticut Judicial Branch's website and emailed to each of you in advance of this meeting. At this point, I'd ask for a motion to approve the recommendations made by the Executive Committee concerning those annual appointments. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Judge Agati has moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Judge Facito. Motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? If not, I will now ask if there are any no votes. Hearing none, are there any abstentions? No votes or abstentions were recorded. Accordingly, the report of the Executive Committee is adopted unanimously. At this point, I'd just like to make a couple of quick closing comments. First, a quick word about assignments. Until things stabilize a bit more, we do not plan to make any immediate action or on assignments or reassignments. While we may have to make one or two targeted reassignments, for instance, as we have done on the habeas docket, or as we may have to do with respect to housing matters, for the most part, at least for the foreseeable future, everyone will remain in their current assignments. At some point over the next few weeks, we may send out the assignment preference request form, but we've made no decisions about that yet either. Secondly, with respect to our senior judges and our judge trial referees, many of whom have continued to work since the crisis began without compensation. Our goal is to get our senior judges and our JTRs back in the lineup, either physically or virtually, as quickly as possible. Fiscal circumstances do not allow us to do that right now, but we will continue to work to find a way to incrementally first get our senior judges back in the lineup, and then we will work on reintegrating JTRs into the workflow. And we will keep you all posted on any developments in that regard as the weeks go by. And I don't know what the next few weeks or months will bring, but I can assure you that as we seek to expand our physical and virtual footprint, the judicial branch we return to will be different from the judicial branch we left behind in early March. Of necessity, the new branch must be more nimble, more responsive, and more cost-effective. We must continue to leverage our emerging technologies and conduct our business differently. We've seen promising new developments deployed already, and those developments will continue. Over the next several weeks, Judge Bizzuto and I are going to set up Teams conference calls in each district to meet with the judges and JTRs assigned to each district to provide all of you with more detailed information about the steps we have taken thus far and what we have planned for the weeks and months ahead. There will be significant challenges ahead, not the least of which may be challenges created by another surge of the virus in Connecticut, as we are seeing now in the rest of the country, and the very significant challenges that will come our way as a result of declining revenues in the state budget. Again, I ask for your patience and your support as we confront those challenges together. I have no doubt that we can meet and overcome those challenges, and as the Chief Justice and I have said from day one, and I will repeat here again, every single step we take will be guided by the goal of mitigating the risks posed by the virus and the desire to keep everyone healthy and safe as we return to our physical workplaces. Finally, since we last met, we have tragically lost several of our friends and colleagues, and I think it is important for us to briefly remember them here and now. Judge Robert Martin, a friend to so many and the husband of Judge Susan Handy, was a dedicated jurist and public servant. In 1981, Judge Martin was elected to the New London City Council, where he served two terms as mayor. He served as judge of the Superior Court for over 29 years, including time spent as a civil presiding judge, an assistant administrative judge, a judge trial referee, and a skillful mediator. I will miss running into Bob at UConn women's basketball games. Judge Kevin DeBay, loved by all who knew him and who appeared before him, Judge DeBay served the bench with wit, integrity, and distinction. Prior to his appointment in 2001, Judge DeBay served as corporation counsel for the city of Hartford, the city in which he lived and cared for passionately. Judge Kara Eschuk was a global jurist. She was born in Cyprus, began her legal career in England, and then emigrated to the United States. Judge Eschuk was passionate about criminal law, and due to her skill and empathy, she became one of the state's leading prosecutors of child abuse cases before she was appointed to the bench in March of 2008. Judge Grant Miller began his legal career in private practice in 1978, and he was appointed to the bench in 2003. Judge Miller served on the complex litigation docket for 8 years and was a respected jurist with a reputation as a highly effective mediator. Judge Tom West began his long and storied career on the bench as a Superior Court judge in February of 1984. In 2002, he was elevated to the appellate court. Judge West was dedicated to the ideals of social justice and serving his community. He was active in a number of community organizations, including the Northern Fairfield County United Way, Campfire Girls, the Danbury Association to Advance the Retarded, and the Danbury branch of the NAACP. If you knew Judge West, you were very lucky. Judge Robert I. Burdun, a veteran of the Korean War, began his legal career in private practice before being elected state treasurer in 1973. Described as a man of compassion, conviction, and courage by the late Chief Justice Frank McDonald, Justice Burdun was first appointed to the bench in 1975 and later elevated by Governor Weicker to serve as a justice of the Supreme Court, where he authored 133 majority, 18 concurrent, and more than 400 dissenting opinions. I should also mention the fact that the judicial branch suffered another tremendous loss as the full impact of the COVID-19 crisis was realized several weeks ago. In late April, we lost a member of the branch family to complications from COVID-19. Jonathan Coelho was an adult probation officer assigned to the Stamford Judicial District. He was beloved by all who knew him and was described as a hard worker with a kind soul. He was 32 years old when he passed away, and he left behind a young wife, Katie, and two little children, Braden, age 2, and Penelope, age 10. I'd ask now that you all join me for a brief moment of silence to remember Judge Martin, Judge DeBay, Judge Eschuk, Judge Miller, Judge West, Judge Burdun, and Jonathan Coelho. Thank you. There being no further business to come before the judges, at this point I'd ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Judge Agati has moved to adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there anyone opposed? The motion carries unanimously. Thank you all for your patience. I think with a few minor technical glitches, this first virtual meeting of the Judges of the Superior Court went very well. Be careful. Thank you.
Thank you.